I'm gonna give her my mic.
I woke up this morning with my mind
stayed on Jesus.
I woke up this morning with my mind
stayed on Jesus.
No, I woke up this morning with my mind
stayed on Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, I woke up this morning with my mind. Come on, y'all.
Stayed on Jesus.
Oh, I woke up this morning with my mind.
Stayed on hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Well, I woke up this morning with my mind
set on Jesus.
Hey, I woke up this morning with my mind
set on Jesus.
You know I woke up
this morning with my mind set on Jesus.
Oh, hallelujah.
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 Hallelujah. Well, it ain't no harm to keep your mind
set on Jesus.
Hey, it ain't no
harm to keep your mind set on Jesus.
You know it ain't no
harm to keep your mind set on Jesus.
Oh, hallelujah.
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 I've been walking and talking to keep my
mind set on Jesus.
Hey.
I've been walking and talking with my mind, set on Jesus.
Oh,
hallelujah.
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 Hallelujah. I've been singing and praying with my mind
set on Jesus.
Hey,
I've been singing and praying with my mind set on Jesus.
I've been singing
and praying with my mind set on Jesus.
Oh, hallelujah.
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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Jesus. Hallelujah. This morning's scripture reading will come from the book of Psalms, the 67, the vision of the Psalms. God be merciful unto us and bless us and cause your face to shine upon us, that your way may be known upon the earth, your salvation among all nations. Let the people praise you, O God. Let all the people praise you. Oh, let the nation be glad and sing for joy. May the Lord add a blessing to the readers here, the mainly doers of his holy word. Let's go before the Lord in prayer. Father, we are so grateful for this day, God. You made this day just for us, oh God. We never seen this day before, never see it again, oh God. So you are a graceful and loving and kind God, our God, the God that created us and know all about us. So God, we come to say thank you this morning, God. We thank you for every good and perfect gift that come down from heaven, oh God. We thank you for your amazing grace that saved the wretch like me. We thank you for your mercies that are new every morning, God. We thank you, God, that we serve in our prayer hearing, God, a prayer answering, God. A God can do anything but fail, God. So we come now, God, to say thank you, God. We come boldly to the throne of grace that we might obtain mercy, to find grace to help in a time of need, God. Realizing we are sinners, God, saved by your grace, God. Realize we all have sinned and come short of your divine glory. Realize the wage of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. But we worship the King, the great I am that I am, the all-knowing God, the all-seeing God, the God that speaketh man that would live and speak again and man would die. God, you are the everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace, oh God. So we thank you this morning, God. But most of all, we thank you for your Son, your only Son, that you offered as a sin sacrifice. Oh God, he gave his life for us, for no man could have taken it. He laid it down freely, God. And we thank you this morning for resurrection power. 3 days later, he got up out of that grave in the name of Jesus, God. It was wonder-working power, God. Oh God, he's still doing signs and wonders, performing miracles. The
blind is seeing, the lame is walking, God. And God, we thank you, God, for this day, God. Oh, God, have your way among your people, God. Someone might get saved today. Someone might get delivered today. Someone might come running crying today, God. Need of a Savior. Need of a God that can do exceedingly abundantly more than they can even ask, oh, God. God, I thank you for this opportunity, God. God, we ask that you bless the preach word, God, that it might not fall on deaf ears today, God. So we worship and praise the King. And God, we thank you for it, oh God. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
Can everybody please put your hands together? Hail Jesus, you're my King.
Hail Jesus, you're my King.
Your life frees me to sing.
Your life frees me to sing.
I will praise you all my day.
I will praise you all my day.
You're perfect in all your ways.
Perfect in all your ways.
Hail Jesus, you're my Lord.
Hail Jesus, you're my Lord.
I will obey your word.
I will obey your word.
Because I want to see your kingdom come.
I want to see your kingdom come.
My will, but yours be done.
My will, but yours be done.
Oh, glory, glory to the Lamb.
Glory, glory to the Lamb.
You will take us into the land.
You will take us into the land.
And we will conquer in your name.
We will conquer in your name.
And proclaim that Jesus reigns.
And proclaim that Jesus reigns.
Oh, hail, hail, Lion of Judah.
Hail, hail, Lion of Judah. How powerful you are.
Hail, hail, Lion of Judah.
Hail, hail, Lion of Judah.
How wonderful you are.
How wonderful you are.
Hail, Jesus, you're my King.
Hail, Jesus, you're my King.
Your life frees me to sing.
Your life frees me to sing.
I will praise you all my day.
I will praise you all my day.
You're perfect in all your ways.
Perfect in all your ways.
Hail Jesus, you're my Lord.
Hail Jesus, you're my Lord.
I will obey your word.
I will obey your word.
Because I want to see your kingdom come.
I want to see your kingdom come.
I will, but yours be done.
My will be yours be done.
Glory, glory to the Lamb.
Glory, glory to the Lamb.
You will take us into the land.
You will take us into the
and
land.
And we will conquer in your name.
We will conquer in your name.
And proclaim that Jesus reigns.
And proclaim that Jesus reigns.
Hail, hail, Lion of Judah.
Hail, hail, Lion of Judah. How powerful you are.
Hail, hail, Lion of Judah.
Hail, hail, Lion of Judah.
How wonderful you are.
How wonderful you are.
Hail, hail, Lion of Judah.
Hail, hail, Lion of Judah.
How wonderful you are.
How wonderful you are.
Hail, hail, Lion of Judah.
Hail, hail, Lion of Judah.
How wonderful you are.
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 How wonderful, wonderful, wonderful.
How wonderful you are.
How powerful 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 you are.
How wonderful you are.
How wonderful you are.
How wonderful you are.
How wonderful you are.
How wonderful, wonderful, wonderful.
How wonderful,
wonderful, wonderful, wonderful, wonderful.
How wonderful you are.
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 How wonderful you
How many of y'all know that it's by God's peace, God's grace, God's glory that we're still here today?
Amen.
How many know that worship is a really sacred place? It's, yeah. it's a place that can get a lot done. Of course, prayer is what we want, but at the end of the day, worship can get you in some great places. Worship can move you. Worship can bring the Lord closer to you. Worship is one of the most important things that we have. So in this time, I ask that you worship. However it is that you worship, just worship. I do
worship.
I really do worship you.
Worship.
Whoa.
I do worship you.
I do
worship.
I really do. Worship you.
Worship.
Whoa, whoa.
I do worship you.
For your goodness.
For your goodness and your glory.
For the joy inside.
For the joy inside your story.
I do. Oh, how excellent!
Oh, how excellent
is your
presence.
We will
bless your name.
For your goodness.
For your goodness and your glory.
For the joy inside,
the joy inside your story.
For the peace you gave
me. For the peace you gave to me.
For the day you
set me free.
For the
goodness and your glory.
For the joy inside. For the peace you gave to me.
For the
pain you set me free.
I do worship.
I really do worship you.
I do worship.
your glory.
And your glory.
Anybody know that it's by God's goodness that we're still all here? For your goodness.
For your goodness.
For your glory.
For your glory. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
He's so faithful.
He's so faithful.
Cause he's always been there. He never left my side. He's so faithful.
He's so faithful.
Anybody know that he's faithful? I said he's faithful. He's so faithful.
He's so faithful.
Do I have any believers? Can I get a witness? He's so faithful. He's so faithful.
He's so faithful.
Yes,
yes, he is. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Yes, he is.
My favorite part right here. Lord, I love you.
Lord, I love you.
Oh, oh, oh Lord, I love you.
Lord, I love you.
Yeah. Lord, I love you. 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 Lord, I love you.
Lord, I love you.
Say right there, Lord, I love you. Lord, I love you. Lord, I love you. Help me say, Lord, I love you.
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 Lord, I love you. Lord, I love you.
Lord, I love you.
Lord, I love you.
Lord, I love you.
Lord,
I love you. Lord, I love you.
Lord, I love you.
Lord, I love you.
Lord, I love you.
I do.
Whoa.
I really do worship you.
I do.
I really do worship you, Lord. I worship you.
Worship you.
You're so faithful. He's so faithful.
He's so faithful.
He's so faithful.
He's so faithful.
Because he's always been there. He's so faithful. He's so faithful.
He's so faithful.
Yes, he,
yes,
is.
He is. Yes, he is.
Lord, I love you.
Lord, I love you.
Lord, 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 I love you. Lord,
Lord, I love you.
Lord, I love you.
Lord, I love you.
Lord, 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 I love you, Lord, I love you, Lord, Lord, I love you, Lord, Lord, yeah. love you.
Anyone out there love him? Come on, anyone out there love him? Come on, lift your hands if you love him. Come on, lift your hands. Come on, if you love him, if you love him. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. As we continue in this spirit of worship, if you don't mind finding two or three people you can touch and agree with as we just enter into a time of prayers, we have truly worshiped, and we're so grateful for all the worshipers in the house. Thankful for our worship team that led us to the throne of grace. And just find two or three people and touch and agree. And so many needs are represented even on our prayer list as you remember them, to pray for them. Continue to hold them up, Sister Petty, Sister Annie White, Brother Bartholomew. Continue to remember the nation of Israel as we hold up that nation in that war-torn land, that God would have mercy. And the Bible instructs us to pray for the peace of Jerusalem, and we want to be obedient to that. And so, wherever your needs rest, we would pray now. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Just want to tell you.
I worship you. I love you, Jesus.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I love you, Jesus. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. I worship and adore you. Yes, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I love you, Jesus. Yes, Lord. Just want to tell you. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah, God. Bless all over this room. Yes, Lord. I love you, Jesus. I worship and adore you. Yes, Lord. 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 I worship and adore you. Just want to tell you. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. We worship and adore you, Lord. We worship and adore you. Just want to tell you, yes. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Let's give the Lord a hand of praise, if you will. Come all over the building. We're so grateful. We're so grateful. Amen. Can we say amen to our worship team again? If they not, come on. If they not, if they not, if they not bless our hearts, they led us to the throne of grace. And for that, we're grateful for their gifts, their talents, their ability. And we're grateful for your presence with us this morning. If we have any first-time guests, if you would just let us know that by the raising of your hand so we can give you a great big God welcome. We have one there, two there. Amen. 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 Sister Jordan, I don't know if they're your guests. Well, I want you to know we have started a Bible class that is full of young tech students, right? Tech students. Amen. 8:30, and Sister McPherson, raise your hand back there, and our beloved First Lady, Sister Brooks, are the teachers of that. Amen, amen. So you're welcome to that. You're welcome to that. Amen. Can we welcome now our online audience? Can we put our hands together and let them know, and just drop a comment, let us know you're watching, and anything you would want to comment on as you're watching, we would appreciate that. If you have your Bibles, turn with us to the great book of Ephesians as we're walking through this book on our spiritual wealth and riches that we have in Christ Jesus, all that God has done for us in Christ. There should, if you don't have a Bible or iPhone, iPad, whatever, there should be a Bible under the seat in front of you if you need to get a hold of that. We'll be in chapter 4 of Ephesians, and those online, join us, please, in the reading of the Word of God. And we're standing here in the church, if you don't mind standing there at the house or wherever you're listening from, and that's out of respect and honor to God's Word. It says in the book of Ezra that they stood from morning to noon in the rain, because they had found and discovered the Word of God. And so we want to join them in that. So chapter 4, I'll be reading out of the New King James Version, whatever translation you have, King James, New King James, NIV, whatever translation. Just read along with us, and we'll meet together around verse 24. Verse 24, starting in verse 17 of chapter 4. And going down to verse number 24. Together, please, verse 17. This I say, therefore, and testify in the Lord, that you should no longer walk as the rest of the Gentiles walk, in the having their understanding darkened, being alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them, because of the blindness of their heart, who being past feeling have given themselves over to lasciviousness, to walk all uncleanness with greediness. But you have not so learned Christ, if indeed you have heard him and has been taught by him as the truth is in Jesus, that you put off concerning the formal conduct, the old man, which grows corrupt according to the deceitful lust. Be renewed in the spirit of your mind, that you put on the new man, which was created according to God in true righteousness and holiness. Father God, we thank you. We thank you for the worship that we have experienced. We thank you for your presence that's here. We ask now your blessing upon your word. God, we ask that you would just go before us and open eyes and open hearts and ears, that we will hear what the Spirit is saying. Lord, we ask that we leave this place changed, yeah, Lord, by the power of your Spirit. And we declare that it's not by power nor might, but it's going to be by your Spirit. Father God, have thine own way. Glorify and magnify thy name, even in the teaching and the preaching, the hearing and the doing of your word. And we ask this in the mighty name of Jesus. And we said, amen, amen and amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Again, we thank God for your presence. We're so excited about what God is doing in our midst in this season. On Wednesday night, we had a time that we looked at our spiritual gifts, that we in this season of life discover what our gifting is, our calling is. It was a tremendous time together. We set up for the fellowship hall, not knowing how many would come, how many of the saints would come out. The saints just kept coming and coming and coming. So we had to revamp that decision, move from the fellowship hall back here to the sanctuary. Everyone for this season in their life that was here, we had over 40 of the members. We're inviting the other 40 or 50 more to come on this Wednesday. We're going to have a fellowship meal. We're going to have the ministry leaders here in order to do the second half of that, and that's to match up your gift with your ministry. Our goal in 2024 is to have 100 ministers at the Community Baptist Church. That's our goal, is to have 100. Now, we're over halfway there, but we're missing you. We're missing you. Just turn to someone and say, we're missing you. You're missing you. We're missing you. Amen. We're missing you. So you come out on Wednesday. We won't hold you long. We'll feed you a meal, a fellowship meal, and we will give those that need the test. The test only take a few minutes to do that. And then we will have the ministry leaders there to match up that ministry with your gifting. And so those that came back, please come back, because you just completed part A and you need to come back to complete part B. And so it's a wonderful thing. We want the every ministry operating in this church, everyone doing their calling. Every believer has been blessed with a spiritual gift. You have one of the gifts mentioned in Romans 12, 1 Corinthians 12. You've been gifted with that spiritual gift. I was blown away, a ton of administrators. We had teachers. We had gifts of mercy, encouragement, you name it. We had the gifts represented, giving all of those gifts. So we're missing your gift. We're missing your talent. We cannot function without you. We had, so it's just coming. If you're a student, come. Because even while you're here, when I was in school, I got saved in school and God used me in school and I grew in school. And I'm grateful for those days of my college years where I came to really know the Lord. Grew up here in Lubbock, but it was down in San Angelo where I came to know Christ and I gave my heart to him. And I began to exercise in a calling that I didn't fully understand, but I knew that what God gave to me in Christ, I had to return back to him with my life. Amen. 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 And so get your Bibles, keep your Bibles open. This morning, we're going to walk through this. I believe that Brother Cooper back there, that this might be one of the most important messages that I've preached since I've been here, if the Lord willing, in May for 34 years. I believe that this morning's message, if God can enable me to make it clear and concise, that we gain an understanding and a sense of what God is saying, possibly could be the most important thing I've said in 34 years of preaching. And I mean that with all my heart. So I need your attention. I need your mind. I need your focus in hearing what the Lord has to say. Amen. Amen. And so here in our text, as we look at the text, the first thing I want to share that if you've been saved that a transformation has happened in your life. You've been transformed with a new nature on the inside of you. You've been what the Bible calls born again with a divine nature. And that nature took place when you got saved. A change happened in your life, that change is so great that it's greater than even when you die. That the change that have taken place in your life when you get born again is the greatest change, even the change that's going to happen when you die. Because at that time, a transformation happened where God implanted into you a divine nature like his nature, and that caused you to be born again. And in that nature, you have newness of life, his uncreated Zoe life. The God kind of life is dwelling in your spirit. It's dwelling in your spirit. You've been born again with newness of life. Hey, beloved, with newness of life. I'm going to let the ushers do their job. I was trying to make sure we get everyone seated. And so we've been given, someone say, newness of life. So a transformation. So you've been fitted for heaven already. You already have heaven on the inside of you. If you're born again, if you know Jesus Christ, then heaven is already on the inside of you. You fitted for heaven. Yeah. Amen. That you are now a citizen of heaven already on earth. That you've been born again. You have the nature of God. You've been fitted for heaven. Heaven is already living on the inside of you. And so when you die, your new nature just goes into those gates and is free from this old body of sin. Amen. Amen. So that's the glorious change that has happened to you if you are a child of God. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says that if any man be in Christ, he's a what now? Old things have passed away, and all, someone say, all things are becoming new. Amen. So you are a new creation. Galatians 2:20 says, I've been crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ lives where? In me. And the life I live now, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Now, in Ephesians chapter 4, Paul's going to make two appeals based on the fact that we as believers are new creatures. Okay, he's going to make two appeals. He makes one in verse number 1 of chapter 4, where he tells us that we ought to walk worthy of the Lord. We ought to have a worthy walk. That means that our walk should match our talk. Okay. Our behavior ought to match our belief. Amen. Our duty ought to match our doctrine. Amen. So we ought to have a worthy walk. And then in verse number 17, come on, stick with me here. In verse number 17, the Apostle Paul's, he contrasts the walk of wicked unbelievers with the walk of spiritual Christians. And so if you're a Christian today, if you've been born again, then your walk ought to be different than the walk of the world. That we are not to walk the same as unbelievers walk. Amen. That there ought to be a difference in how we behave and how we walk if we're truly born again. In other words, a changed nature demands a changed behavior. That you cannot say that you've been changed and you've been born again and still walking like the world. Amen. That there ought, come on, someone, there ought to be a difference in our walk compared to the walk of unbelievers. Amen. That's what Paul is getting at. And so he's going to give 7 traits of the walk of the old man or the old self. This is the walk. He's going to contrast our old walk with our new walk, or the walk of those that are unbelievers with the walk of those that are believers. Amen. And so there ought to be a different kind of walk.
First of all, the walk of the unbelievers or the old man or the pagan is self-centered thinking. That's your first point. Self-centered thinking. Useless thinking. Useless thinking. That's the walk of unbelievers. That's the walk of the pagans. That's the walk of non-Christians. That their walk is contained in self-centered thinking. Amen. Self-centered thinking. And so Paul says, he starts out in verse 17 by saying, therefore. Therefore is always there for a reason. Therefore is in light of what he had said in verses 1 through verse number 16. That we ought to have a worthy walk, and that means we ought to walk lowly, we ought to walk with meekness, we ought to walk with long suffering. We have to, because we're trying to keep the unity of the Spirit. I want to declare that all of those that came to join into the body and function in your gift, you're going to need to walk in a lowly way. You're going to need to learn how to claim the meekness of Christ, and meekness is just power under self-control. Amen. Whenever you involve this closely in working with people, you're going to need some self-control. Amen. You're going to need some patience. It's kind of like being married. Amen. And marriage will teach you patience and self-control. Amen. Because the Bible says the two become what now? One. Amen. And so there has to be some adjustments made if this thing is going to work. Amen. And so he says, this I say, therefore, in light of all that God has done for us in verses 1 through verse 16 and all that he has blessed us with, he has given us gifted men to equip us for the work of the ministry, that you do the work of the ministry. You edify the body of Christ by using your spiritual gift until we come into the oneness of the faith, unto the knowledge of the Son of God, and to a perfect man, that we be no more children tossed to and fro, carried about with every wind of doctrine by the trickery of man and the cunning work of Satan, but that we speak the truth in love and we grow up into him. Someone say, grow up. Grow up into him in all things. The great need of my life and your life is to grow up. If you're taking notes, just write that down. Lord, help me to grow up. Come on. I don't care how old you are. Amen. Ladies, I know most of the ladies here are under 50, but the great exhortation. I'm going to get some amens out of that. The great, you online too. I know that too. So the great exhortation is in the need in the church is a need for us to grow up. Amen. Amen. What if everyone in the church this year make a decision that I'm going to grow up? I'm going to become a full grown man and a full grown woman. Amen. And so that is it. When I was a child, I act like a child. But when I became mature, what did I do? I put away childish things and attitudes and those kind of things. I became full grown. And so that we might function in the body, we might do our part. If everyone does their part in the body, then the body's going to grow itself. Amen. I believe that in this room now, there are teachers that are not teaching. There are administrators. There are everything we need to function is in this room. I don't think we have to go out. I don't think we have to send to Dallas or Houston or L.A. I think God will raise up everything that he needs. It's in the house. Come on, it's in the house. And so you have to, though, get in your role, grow to the place where God can use you in order to function in the call and the position he has called you to do. Amen? Amen. Just lean over and tell someone we need you. Come on, we need you. Tell them we need you to function. Come on. Tell them we need you to function with your unction. Yeah. We need you. We need you. I need my hands. I need my toes. I need my arms, my feet, my legs, my eyes. I need my intestines. I need my muscles and my veins, and I need my mouth and my head. I need every part of my body in order for this thing to work. Can I get a witness? And so you are needed, beloved. You are unique. No one can do what you do like you can do it. Amen. Amen. I won't be able to say that again, but no one can. Your call is unique to your calling. Amen. Amen. It's unique to Brother Ben. Brennan is up in the preacher's seat. Amen. He has. Whew, boy, I needed another one, Mike, and I got him. Whew, thank you, Lord. Isn't the Lord amazing? I mean, we're talking about gifting, and one just slipped up here. Lord, you're amazing. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. All right. All right. All right. Okay. Who else got three more seats up here? All right. Amen. Self-centered thinking. This is the ungodly, though. This is our old life. He says, therefore, I testify in the Lord. Now, he's saying here, Paul is saying, God is speaking. This is not Paul. This is not Pastor Brooks, but the Lord is talking right now. I testify in the Lord that henceforth you walk not. The word walk means to conduct ourselves. It's how we order our behavior, if you're taking notes. It's how we conduct our daily lives. That's our spiritual walk. That we walk not as the other Gentiles walk. Now, the Gentiles mentioned in 1 Thessalonians 4 and 5 are those that know not God. That those are the Gentiles, those that know not God. These are people, unbelievers, that we're not to walk as other Gentiles walk. And it says in the vanity of their minds. Someone say vanity. Vanity means that which is vain, aimless, without purpose, without results. It has to do with that that has no cause. It talks about not walking after our own thinking, chasing our own bubbles, not walking after the vanity of our own mind. That in our own thinking, apart from God, how many understand that there's really no much purpose in life without Christ? Can I get away? It's really vain. It's really vain kind of living. You've been there. It's getting up in the morning. It's adjusting your face. It's leaving, getting in the car. It's going to work or going to school and seeing the same old folks and the same old stuff. And then it's coming home, it's eating a little bit, it's watching some TV, it's being on your phone for a while. And then it's going to bed, it's getting up, it's doing the same thing. And really it gets to the point of just being vain living. I remember that. I was gonna be a lawyer in school. And I want, and it was to make money and all that law would bring and do for me. And then God had to arrest me. He got me arrested in a lot of ways. And it had to do with my thinking process, because I understood even at that time that was not really going to bring me purpose. That still there's a vanity in all of that. There's a vainness in all of that. The man that had all the money, the man that had all the power by the name of Solomon said this. That all is vanity, all is chasing after the wind. That there's no. He had all the money, so many wives, 800 wives, but he decided in all of that life was vain. It was vanity. Have you ever tried to get something? You got it, but it didn't really make you happy. And you wanted something else, and you got it, and you got it, and it didn't make you happy. You wanted that car, that ride, man. If I could just get this car, I know, man, this is going to do it. But you got it. You roll around in it a couple of years, but it just didn't do what you thought it was going to do. Amen. You say, man, if I can get, ladies, if I can get this man, if I can just get.
Wait a minute.
All right. our brothers, I can just find this one. If I can find the one, the one, the one, if I can find the one, I know it's going to make me happy. You know what I found out? If you're lonely before you got married, there's only one man. And the woman at the well said, I found a man.
That's all right, sir.
Who told me everything I know. And yet he still loved me. Come on, tell someone one man. And so here, so it's selfless thinking. It's chasing your own thoughts. That's the pagan. That's the ungodly. That's to those that know not Christ. It's vain thinking, empty thinking, worthless thinking, no purpose in life, frustrated, empty, not fulfilled, not happy, not satisfied. And that leads to something else. The second thing is a darkened understanding. Notice he says, having the understanding darkened. The word darken means it's in the perfect tense. It's to darken or blind the mind. It speaks of a completed thing that happened in the past that has present results. Come on, you have to stay with me on this one. Paul is speaking here to show the finished and permanent results of the blindness of the mind by sin. It says in Corinthians that the God of this world has blinded the mind of the unbeliever. And so everyone in this world, their mind is blinded by Satan. They're living in darkness. Their mind having, look at the text, having their minds darkened. That something happened in the past that's having results today. Amen. And the scary part is a permanent thing. It's a permanent thing. And then notice he says in the text, being alienated from the life of God. This speaks of being separated or cut off from one's fellowship and being intimate with God, cut off from God's life. It refers to being in a state of moral darkness, and they become alienated from the life of God. They're dead to God. That people in the world are dead to God. They're really dead men walking. They have no spiritual life because they're walking according to their own empty thinking and following their own counsel, their own advice, their own ways. And that leads to a darkened mind or a darkened understanding. They become shut off from the life of God. They have no Zoe life. They have no divine life. They only have mental, soulish life that is not eternal. And they know that. They know that because most of the things on the mind of unbelievers is death. They talk about death. They think about death all the time because something inside of them is telling them that they have to get right with God before they punch their ticket out of planet Earth. Amen. That there's a conscience. There's something inside telling every man, woman, boy, and girl that I have to get right with God before I leave planet Earth. Because if I do not and I leave planet Earth, I will spend an eternity separated from God. Okay, and so being alienated from the life of God through the ignorance that is in them, the ignorance of divine things. They don't know. Solomon says, Paul says over in Timothy that they're ever learning, but never comes to the knowledge of the truth. And in fact, over in Romans, it says, because they rejected God, professing to be wise, they became fools.
Yeah.
And so he says, because of the blindness of their hearts. In other words, their heart, that word blindness means hardening, that their hearts hardens. That it's the process, like when a bone is broken, there's a material that comes and it hardens. And sometimes that material, come on, medical people, is harder than the bone itself because of the hardening process. And this has to do, listen, this has to do with someone that is ungodly, that walks in their own imaginations and thinking, and have gotten to a place where they're living in a darkened state, and they continue to make decisions that are not godly. And in those decisions, if they stay walking in those decisions, then the scripture says that God will harden their heart in a permanent way to confirm them in the decisions that they are making. Bible reads, you remember Pharaoh? When the miracles kept happening, the Bible says, and Pharaoh hardened his heart. And Pharaoh hardens his heart. And then all of a sudden, boom, and God hardened his heart. Anyway, you can walk in sin and disobedience long enough that there's a line that you can cross. And I don't know where that line is, but God knows where that line is. And if you cross that line and continue to reject the light, reject the Holy Spirit, reject the word of God, reject the counsel of God, then you cross that line and God will harden you in your lifestyle. You can choose a certain lifestyle that is not godly, and God has forbidden that lifestyle. But if you choose to walk in that lifestyle, God will speak to you, deal with you, send prophets, send missionaries, send parents, send the word, send the Holy Spirit, send earthquakes, send wars, send rumors of wars, send all of that to shake your world in order for you to come to your senses to know that you got to do it God's way, for the wages of sin is still. And so, if you walk in your own thinking, and you continue to walk, there's a line you can cross in that lifestyle where God will harden your heart and you become blind to the point that that's a permanent decision that you cannot change, because you become hardened in your sin, blind because of the blindness of their heart. They became darkened in their hearts, to the ignorance that was in them because of the blindness of their heart. This is a serious matter. Because if you're walking in sin right now, if you're leading a double life, you're walking in fornication, that's sex outside of marriage. In fact, any sex outside of marriage is sin. Sex with a woman and a man and a man, the Bible in Romans calls it sin. In fact, when God judges a nation, there's two things that happen. A sexual revolution that happens in Romans 1, happened in the 60s, 70s, y'all remember? Sexual revolution, all about love, nothing's new under the sun. And that revolution will lead, according to Romans, I'll let you read it, to a homosexual revolution where men will lust after men and women will lust after women. And they get to a place where in our text, it says they were past feelings. The third point is they became shameless. There was no more shame in their game. And what was in the closet came out of the closet. And they didn't care anymore. Uh-huh. They didn't care if anyone knew or didn't know. Uh-huh. because their thinking process led them to a darkened heart, to blindness, where they were spiritually blind, and they crossed a point. You can do that as a nation.
Amen.
And God will give you over to that sin.
Uh-huh. Amen.
Where things are done today in the open, paraded, that grandma and great grandma would have never dreamed.
Yes, sir. Amen.
See, I'm trying to keep someone out of hell this morning. I don't care what y'all think. I'm going to have to stand here. And he says, son, do you remember on April the 14th at Community Baptist? Were you there? Yeah, I was there.
Uh-huh.
You remember I gave you an assignment? Yeah. You remember it was from verses 17 to 24? And I didn't want you to skip any verses. I want you to preach every one of them.
Uh-huh.
And because I didn't want anyone's blood on your hands.
Yes, sir.
I was fornicating when I was in the world, and I'm glad someone told me that that was a sin.
Uh-huh.
Amen. Amen. No, I know y'all shocked. I'm sorry. Girls, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I know no one else in the house have that kind of life. I know no one else came out of that kind of stuff. You know, most of these folks grew up saved from 3 or 4 years old. But I was a great sinner. I have to admit, and I met a great Savior.
Yes, sir.
Amen. Come on, I met a great Savior.
That's good. That's good.
And I'm so glad. I'm so glad in March of 1977 at St. Paul Baptist Church in San Angelo, Texas, that an evangelist all the way from California came and told me the truth. My little knucklehead back there somewhere in the back, God convicted me of my sin. I came up to the front and asked the question, what can I do to be saved? I'm so glad. I'm so glad. And all I'm trying to do, because the world's not going to tell you this. Coach is not going to tell you this. Most of church folks won't even tell you this. But your preacher ought to tell you this. And so the Bible says that you cross that line and God will give you over to that sin. He'll give you over to it. Look at the text, lasciviousness. Lasciviousness is wanton, unbridled lust, where it's out of control. Lust, where you'll do anything to get it. It's unbridled. It's wanton lust. And he'll turn you over to that particular sin, where there becomes no shame to your game. It masters you.
Yeah.
That sin, it can be alcohol. And alcohol, you take one, well, I was there too. You take one step and you take another step.
Amen.
And another drink.
Amen.
And another drink and another drink, and you can become a drunk.
Amen.
Where you live for the next drink. And alcohol becomes your idol. Just like sex can become your idol. And you become so hardened against God that he gives you over to that sin in a permanent way, that you become fixed in that particular sin. And he says, the next part of that says, you'll do it with greediness. You'll be greedy to commit that sin. and work all uncleanness. How many know that uncleanness today is a big business? Pornography.
Amen.
Billions of dollars. Because the world, the devil, is greedy after your soul.
Amen.
Your destiny. Your calling. Can I get a witness?
Amen.
He wants you.
Come on, Pastor.
And he will do all he can to get you. Can I get a witness?
Amen.
So what Paul is saying here is that a believer has to be different from an unbeliever.
Uh-huh.
Is that if your life is marked by a lifestyle of sin, it's a good chance that you're not saved.
Uh-huh.
I don't care what your title is. I don't care. Not that Christians don't fall. The Bible says a righteous man falls how many times? But he does what? And then he can fall in another time. But he what? He gets back. He doesn't wallow. He doesn't. A pig, it says in Peter. I know none of you grew up in the country. But a pig loves the what? In the what? That's the nature of a pig. But a sheep, they stay away from. In fact, they know that bad company even. So they don't hang around pigs.
Yeah.
A dog. I don't, we ain't checked, but a dog will return. Once he has vomited the stuff out on the altar in front of the elders, they'll go back out on a Saturday night or a Friday night or a Thursday night, and they'll return to their what? Because they're what? Now they got a dog, but a dog. Because their nature has not changed. I know that sin is a serious matter.
Amen.
And the wages of sin is death. And what he means by that is that when we sin, sin has its own punishment. And when sin is working in our lives, it's going to produce death. Corruption. That's what we have. It's a cancer. We have to cut it off.
Amen.
We have to stop. In fact, the analogy is here. If I was out all day working in the yard and I had to deal with dogs, if I had dogs and all of that, cleaning dogs and all of that, and in the garden, dirty, smelly, and I took, Sister Brooks wouldn't even let me, Brother Anson, bring the clothes in the house.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
It would be so bad.
Yes, sir.
That I would have to keep them in the garage.
Yes,
so I go in the house and I take a bath and I'm clean, smell good. What would it look like if I went back out and put on those same dirty clothes? And that's what Paul's saying. If you've been bathed in the blood, you've been washed in the blood.
Come on,
if you've been redeemed by the blood.
Yes.
Come on, if you're a child of God,
yes.
Why are you wearing the same old dirty clothes that you used to wear back then?
Come on. Yes.
Tell someone to put them off. Put them off. Put them off. We're different. We don't walk like the Gentiles. In fact, the Bible says over in verse number 20, it is, he says that if you have known Christ or heard of Christ, for the truth is in Christ, then you got to put off that old conversation. How do you know if you're saved? I'm saved because March of 1977, San Angelo, Texas, I made a decision for Christ. Nope. Uh-huh. How's my walk now?
Mm. Yeah. Yes, all right.
Amen. How's my lifestyle? Am I walking in the vanity of my mind? My heart's being darkened. I'm alienated from the life of God, hardened because of my sin. Have I given myself over to some secret sin that only God and I know about? And if I have, and I'm living a lifestyle of that, John says, he who practices sin is not saved. Practice, that's the key word. I think I've discharged my duty.
All right.
I think everyone knows whether they're saved or not saved. And it all has to do with your persistent conduct. Not that we don't struggle as believers, not that we don't even fall, but you can't live the same life as the world.
Yeah.
Amen. Amen.
And call ourselves Christians, because we're not. I'm just going to tell you, we're not. You're not saved. You're not a child of God. Can I tell all the gifted ones that came? I was thinking, wow, wouldn't it be great to bring a speaker in and confirm what happened? But you know what the Lord told me? He told me this message alone. Because you don't need to really come up here if you're not saved. If you're not living a holy, godly life in righteousness and true holiness, then you don't need to really, you can't function. If you have no life of God, you cannot function. You know, the greatest joy I've ever had in ministry is when I see people that's been in the church for a long time come down to make sure they're saved. That's the greatest joy I've had, because they want to be sure. And they don't care what people think. They just want to know that they're saved and they're born again and they've been implanted with the nature of God. Come on, everyone's standing. Everyone's standing.
Amen.
Let a man examine themselves and see if he's in the faith. How many know that last night was pretty tough for most saints? See those bombs go over into Israel. Because that's where it's going to happen. Beloved, that's where it's going to happen. When all the nations turn away, and Brother Cooper, the man of sin, steps in and defends Israel. And I think this country is pretty close to turning away from Israel. And, well, it doesn't surprise me, because I believe that we're under the judgment of God already because of our great sin. And we are parading that sin in the face of God. Come on, every head bowed, every eye closed. No one moving, no one stirring. We're in the valley of decision. God told me if I preach this message, that he would be faithful. If there's anyone in the house, in the presence of God, would say, I don't really know if I'm saved. My lifestyle sometimes is a pattern of walking in my own thinking. My heart is hardened sometimes. There's a blindness. And I've been given over to this thing. And I want to get free. I want to know that I know from this day forward that things are well with my soul. And if one person in the house would heed the call, God will be pleased. And so if that's you this morning, and the Lord is speaking to your heart, like I did that Sunday morning, I didn't look around. I just ran down to the altar. I ran to the altar. And I asked Jesus to save me. Grew up in the church, baptized, served in the church, but just was as lost as I could be. So if that's you, I want you to come. You might be visiting today. We're not asking you to join the church right now. We're asking you to make sure things are well with your soul. Come on, saints, I need for you to pray. I need for you to pray. But I believe there's someone in the valley of decision, someone that's given themselves over to sin and to more sin and to more sin. Their hearts are being hardened. The cement is being poured into their heart, and they're getting further away from God. And God is calling you home. He's calling you back. Don't keep walking down that road, beloved. Don't keep walking. You're going to get harder and harder and harder and harder, alienated from the life of God, blind, giving yourselves over to it, unrestrained. That sin is wrong. He hates it. God hates it. And you have to hate it. But you got to come against yourself even and give yourself to the Lord. Anyone here? Come. Anyone sense tugging of the Holy Spirit, the move of God on your life, the drawing? Come on, saints, pray. Time to get saved, beloved. Time is short. Time is short. Today, if you hear my voice, please don't harden your heart. It's a serious thing. It's a serious thing. And the key, beloved, you're either saved or you're not. Can't be both ways. So if God is tugging on you, pulling on you, and the brothers, they'll meet you halfway. They'll meet you if you're here. If you're here, won't you come? He has to be the center. It's all about you. Come on, if you're here, come. Thank you. You just want to give your heart to the Lord. You want to do it. You want to give it once and for all. Once and for all. You want to walk in holiness. You want to walk in righteousness. You don't want to walk in corruption and unrighteousness. But you want to throw off those clothes. And you want to walk according to the will of God. Is there anyone else? Anyone else? Come out from among them and be ye separate. Touch not the unclean thing. The conviction of the Holy Spirit is upon you. God is stirring your heart. Please be obedient. The sun that will melt the clay will harden it also. So make your way down. Just don't see who's coming, who's not coming. I came by myself, this little, 19-year-old kid. But I was tired. I was sick and tired. Tired of living it, drinking, trying to smoke.
Yes, Lord. Yes, God. Yes, God.
My life was in a mess. It was coming apart. God brought you here this morning, beloved. He brought you here to hear this word. I don't care how long you've been in the church. Doesn't matter. I don't care how many times you've been baptized. It doesn't matter.
Thank you, Jesus.
I don't care what title you have. It doesn't matter. I don't care if you're a good person. It doesn't matter. The question is, are you a saved person? Are you a saved person? Many are coming down to make that commitment. Many are coming down to, once and for all, they're going to throw off the old. They're going to embrace Christ as the center of their lives. They're going to know when they leave here that things have happened. A change has happened. They're going to stop walking away from God and start walking to God. They're coming out. Coming out of the world, coming out of the system, coming out of themselves. They're giving their heart, they're giving their life. They're giving their bodies, they're giving their minds, their wills, their emotions. Come on, today is the day of salvation. Today, if you hear my voice, please don't harden your heart. The call of God is now. Come now, come while there's time. Come while there's time, beloved. Come on, don't let God give you over to that thing. Don't let him give you over to it. Come on, don't let him give you over to it. You got to let God break it. You got to let him break it. Every chain, come on, every chain has to be broken. You can't live a lifestyle like that. You can't walk both ways at one time. You got to make a decision. You have to make a decision. Can't walk in the counsel of your own mind, your empty, vain thinking, darkened heart, alienated from the life of God through the blindness of your heart, being past feeling, giving yourself over to lasciviousness, to work all uncleanness with greediness. Got to put on Christ. You got to put him on, beloved. Got to put him on. Those that have come down, we want to put something in your hands. Those that have come down, please stay for just a moment. Or maybe you need to stand in the gap for someone. Maybe you need to stand in the gap for a child, a grandchild. In these last days, beloved, we don't know how much time we have left, but it's short. I do know that. The time is short. So the call of God is now, beloved. The old ship of Zion is getting ready to take off. We're getting ready to be raptured, getting ready to be taken out of here. And the question is, are you ready? Are you ready? If it should happen today, are you ready? Are you ready? Come and get ready. Come and get ready, beloved. Come and get ready. In hell, it's going to be, let those that are unclean be unclean still. Let those that are unjust be unjust still. You won't be able to change. You won't be able to change, beloved. You won't be able to change. You'll be confirmed in your sin. You'll be confirmed. You'll be given over to your sin. Come clean. Come clean. Come clean. That's the word. Come clean. Cast off those old garments. The old clothes. Get rid of them. Get rid of them. For those that are coming for salvation, please stay. Please stay. For those that are coming to make sure they're saved, please stay. In fact, if you don't mind, Sister Chambers taking those back to the room. And those that came down for salvation, those that are giving your hearts to the Lord, it's a wonderful thing. It's a wonderful thing. It's a wonderful thing. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you, Father. Thank you. Those online, we don't want to forget about you. You have to make a decision on whose side you're on. You have to decide today if you're going to come out, give your heart to Christ and follow him. So if you call upon the name of the Lord, you shall be saved. You shall be saved. You shall be saved. You shall be saved. So it's time to get saved, beloved. It's time not to play any more games. You know the way to walk. Your conscience is still with you. You know this word was just for you. It was just for you. You can run, you can hide, but God knows and you know. You got to come out from that, beloved. It's going to kill you. It's going to destroy you. The wages of sin is death. It's going to destroy your mind, your will. God has a wonderful plan for your life, a wonderful plan. But you got to walk in it. You got to obey him. You got to let him get you out of that. So God is begging. The Holy Ghost is pleading with someone to come out from that. Come out and be ye separate and touch not the unclean thing. The culture, the world, the devil, the sin. Today is your day. Today is your day. The Bible says, harden not your heart. Harden not your heart. Oh God. How many know that salvation is a beautiful thing? Can I get a witness? How many is glad that they know the Lord? Glad they're walking in obedience and righteousness. Not that we're perfect, but we're walking under the anointing of God's Spirit, trying to obey him and do what he's called us to do in these very last days, the end times. So we're here. I just sense somebody is weeping for someone. They're weeping. There's a weeping going on, a wailing. There's a wailing. Some father, some mother, some grandfather for their child. And I know we got to go, but there's a wailing and a weeping over you. And you might be a student here, but involved in some things you shouldn't be involved in. But someone is weeping and crying and wailing over your life for you to come out from that. Get back with God. Get right with God. And their heart is broken now. And that path that Paul lays out in Ephesians 17 through 24 ends up in a horrible place. A horrible place. A permanent place of blindness. And a hard heart, an eternity without God. The choices you make today will determine your destiny tomorrow. And what is fun today will be death tomorrow. Choose this day.
This day, thank you, Lord.
Whom you gonna serve?
Amen.
But as for me and my house, come on, somebody. And I need some mother, some father to say, I'm not going to let my baby, my grandbaby, my child, I'm not going to let the enemy win this battle. Come on, somebody. I need somebody with a faith to know that God is able. Come on, God is able. Can I get a witness? He's able. So I want you to be encouraged. Mom, be encouraged. Dad, be encouraged. Be encouraged. God's going to win this battle. God's going to win this battle. You just hang on in there. You hang on in there. Come on, everyone standing. Everyone standing. Yes.
I'd like to say something this morning. My grandson. And so I wanted to pray for me this morning. my great grandson, Cody. You know, I had lost my three brothers this past year. He told me that I'll see him again when I get to heaven. He told me that he said, you still got Grandma. You got Grandma Dover. You got still got all your sisters. He said, but you'll see him again when you get to heaven. That was so special to me. It broke my heart. I love you so much. He's a special little boy. So we pray for Kate. That's Kate Anderson right there, his little brother. Oh, God, I just can't believe some things he says sometimes. So I just wanted to say that. I thought it was so special, especially to me, if it wasn't special for nobody else. Thank you.
If you don't mind taking someone by the hand and whispering a prayer for that person next to you, on your right and on your left. God is really wanting to do some things in this season, and He doesn't want to do it without you. He doesn't want to do it without you. So I want you to whisper a prayer. You have no idea what they're going through, what they've been through, or maybe what they're even getting ready to go through. But we're the body of Christ. We're joined one to the other. We're united. And so as you pray, the anointing of God is flowing throughout this building. So everyone from the top of their head to the bottom of their feet, God, let a fresh anointing, let it rest upon them in the mighty name of Jesus. And just take a moment and pray.
Thank you, God. Father God, just praying for
that. Pray that they might truly come to the faith. And pray if they're in the faith, that they might be established.
Thank you, Lord.
Giving them a heart.
In the name of Jesus. Pray for their health. Pray for their mind, their will, their emotions. Pray for their families, their parents, brothers and sisters.
Yes, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Pray in this season that they will fulfill all the will of God. They would know what to do.
Yes, Lord.
They would understand the times.
Yes, Lord.
And they would know what to do.
Yes, Lord.
They find their place in the body. In Jesus' name. Father God, right now in the name of Jesus, let your anointing fall on this place. Your grace and your mercy. Every need. Every situation, God. Everything that's broken,
God.
Fix it right now. In the mighty name of Jesus. Touch every situation, God. Touch every household. Touch every family right now. God, we draw the bloodline. In the mighty name of Jesus, we draw it around our children. We draw it around our mates. We draw it around our families. In the mighty name of Jesus. God, that you would move. You would move by your spirit, God. In the name of Jesus. Breaking every yoke, loosening every bondage, and setting every captive free. God, we stand on your promise that whatever we ask in your name, you said you'll do it, God. It's under your feet, God. Sickness is under your feet. Oh, division is under your feet. Satan is under your feet, God. Addictions are under your feet, God. In the mighty name of Jesus. So we declare victory in this place. We declare deliverance in this house, God. Oh, God. Oh, God. in the mighty name of Jesus. And we'll give you all the glory. Come on, somebody. All the honor. All the praise, God. It belongs to you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Put your hands in and give him glory. Give him glory. God bless you. God bless you. Oh, thank you. Thank you. Bless you, we'll take. Oh my, had to get that one out.
I've seen many places and many faces I've come to know. Times I've celebrated.